Hello, everybody. My name is Thomas Pryor, and I'm an undergraduate at the University of Washington, and I'm one of the inventors of SignAloud, along with Navid Azodi. And so SignAloud is a hand gesture interpretation apparatus initially purposed towards translating physical elements of physical languages, such as sign language, into text and speech. So I want to get started by asking you guys a question. How many of you guys maybe know what a hackathon is? A few of you? Oh, a lot of you. Okay, wow. Okay, so this should be all pretty familiar. So at a hackathon, it's typically an inventing competition. A lot of the times it's purposed towards computer coding, but there are also hackathons focusing in the biotech world, as Catherine pointed out before, and there are also hackathons focusing on transportation. But kind of a key element of hackathons is that they take place over the course of 24 to 48 hours. So as you can probably imagine, a lot of these events are pretty heavily caffeinated, and people typically don't sleep. And they're aimed at problem solving, overcoming challenges, improving previous inventions, and other pieces of innovation. So events like this are sponsored by large tech companies, Google, Microsoft, Amazon, and as well as smaller startups. And so a lot of these companies like to give their technology for people to build upon. So there's a lot of open source technology, APIs, and hardware available for you to tinker with. And mentors are also available to help out. So what a hackathon is doing is it's creating this environment where all the resources are in one place. All of these people that are really inventive and creative and willing to help out are in one place. And it's really amazing to see what kind of things can come out of a hackathon. So we have a hackathon every year at the University of Washington. It's Dub Hacks. And it was at an event like this where we initially came up with this challenge of how do you take elements of a physical language, such as American Sign Language, and turn it into text and speech. Now you may think, well, that's already been done before. Microsoft has a few patents on translating sign language from text to speech using the Microsoft Kinect, but that's not really practical for everyday use. And there are many other inventions out there that have sensors all over the hands, wrist, and body, but that's not really practical. So what we really set out to do was make something in the form of a consumer device that people could use every day. And so it was at a hackathon in my hometown in Arizona where we made the first prototype of SignAloud. So keep in mind this was made over the course of 36 hours, so that's why it looks the way it does. But I'll kind of point out some key elements here. So what it was is there were some sensors on my hand and wrist that were measuring my hand position and movement. And all of this data was taken from my hands to this circuit board strapped to my chest right here. And this Arduino right here was taking in all this data and it was looking and it was seeing, all right, which of these gestures corresponds to template words or phrases in sign language, and then it puts them out through a text-to-speech module right here. Now, what was really difficult with this, and given the time constraint, it's kind of understandable, is that our major problem was we didn't really know where a lot of our problems were coming from because it was so convoluted. So sometimes it wouldn't look like, well, is this an electrical issue or is this a hardware issue or a coding issue? So it's always good to be neat when you make your prototypes. But eventually we did get it working. So here's a short video of it working. Please keep in mind this was made in 36 hours, so that's why it works the way it does.
Translator. Translator. How?
So that was the first iteration of SignAloud, and amazingly enough, we actually ended up winning this hackathon, and through that, we got a lot of publicity, and it really opened our eyes to the potential that an invention like this could have. People came to us and said, this has a lot of applications in the VR world for enhanced dexterity in virtual reality, and this also has a lot of implicative applications in the biotech world. So what we really, after the hackathon, we looked back and we said, well, there are a lot of things we can improve on with this. So we had to separate what we wanted out of the invention and what we needed to attain that want. So the first thing was, this has to be more ergonomic if it's to be in the form of a consumer device. So what do we need? The wires got to go, and the circuit board has to get a lot smaller. So we used wireless modules, and we made our own circuit boards. And then we want better hand resolution since we saw that there were so many other applications for a device like this, so we decided to put more sensors on the glove. And as well, we wanted faster gesture recognition, so we had to be a lot smarter with the algorithms that we were using in our coding, and we needed a better processor to do that as well. So we looked at this and we're like, wow, we need to do a lot. Where can we get resources to do this? Where can we find people that can help us out to do this? And so that's where we looked at our university and we found out about the makerspace at our university. So a makerspace is kind of similar to a hackathon. So at a makerspace, there's a laboratory. It's a laboratory for student projects. And this laboratory has no specific area of research. And students are always open to go and work on personal projects of their own. And there are laser cutters, 3D printers, printed circuit board fabricators. So there's a lot of physical hardware for us to use. And there are student employees there to help out. So very similar to a hackathon, all these resources are in one place. And all these great people are in one place to help you make a great invention. So it was there where we could finally make a second version of SignAloud, which is our current iteration. So this is what they look like now. Definitely a lot more ergonomic than before. Kind of some parallels. We still have the sensors on the finger. However, we added more sensors and a sensor on the index finger. And there's the circuit board on the wrist. So kind of the takeaway with this is don't be afraid to go out there and find those resources. And don't be afraid to go out and network with people. And it's really, really amazing what you can find when you just ask for the help. So always surround yourself with those people who help turn those innovative gears in your mind and help you turn your ideas into inventions. Thank you.
We actually have a couple minutes for questions. If there are any questions from the audience, we do have a couple roving mics here. If you'd like to ask them,
have you thought about the different complexities of American Sign Language and the similarities between different hand gestures? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so there are a lot of intricacies and nuances in American Sign Language, and there are different signs that can mean very different things when you make different facial expressions and depending on the context of what you're signing. So as we move forward with this, we'll definitely be working closer with members of the community to tailor this to the syntactical structure of ASL itself.
Hey, congratulations on all your projects and your inventions. I wonder how much do you consider the potential market as you're hacking away and as you're thinking, is this actually a viable product?
So a few of you may remember the Nintendo Power Glove. That's a familiar thing. So kind of the issue that happened with that was the technology was ahead of its time. And so now I think is the time where devices like this could really be helpful, especially in the virtual reality world. So the market is definitely a lot bigger and more diverse and more accessible for us now than it was before.
Are there any plans to adapt this technology for other sign languages? Because I know that outside of American Sign Language, there are also other languages.
Right. Yeah, so with tailoring this towards other sign languages, it requires making building larger and larger databases. But for now, I think we're focusing on just American Sign Language. Yeah. But kind of the development requires working with a whole other community in another country as well. So
this looks awesome. Really nice job.
Thank you.
Right here. Just wondering, what's the next step for you? What comes next?
Definitely we'll be going towards user testing and tailoring this to the actual syntactical language structure of American Sign Language itself.
I was just wondering, how vast is the database of words that you have so far?
So our database right now has about 50 gestures. It's decomposed into morphemes, which is kind of like the atoms of languages. It's the smallest syntactical structure. So different pairs of morphemes and gestures constitute different words and phrases. And so I think in ASL, for the hand, it's about 48 morphemes, and those coupled with gestures make the words.
Is there a setting, or do you plan on implementing a setting to personalize the gloves for somebody? For instance, if I have the gloves, I can personalize it and put a family member's name in it, so I can say, Johnny, can you pass me the salt, or something like that?
Yeah, yeah. So definitely, and that's how we record signs now. We have the gloves recorded them, so there would definitely be functionality to input ASL names in there as well.